I know we have a mixed audience here tonight. There are students who are studying Irish manuscripts. Other students come with a literary background. So we have art historians, literary critics. Some people maybe know the work of James Joyce, some don't. But my particular avenue to the Book of Kells was through James Joyce. I didn't begin with the Book of Kells, I began with Joyce. And I was doing work. That's great. Yeah, great. Good. Yeah. You okay with that? Can you all see us?
Yes.
Okay. Tell me what it says, okay, when you get a chance. That's part of the theme here today, the thesis here today, is learning to read. Oops, this must be timed out somehow. Learning to read pages like the Book of Kells helps you understand why Joyce felt that the reading process, the acquisition of letters and of words, was crucial to the Irish literary experience. So I want to talk about art history, but also whatever continuity might exist in the Irish literary tradition. A lot of people would look to the Irish literary tradition and point to Yeats, right, to Swift, and that's the Anglo-Irish literary tradition, as rich as it might be. When Yeats looks back on his forebears, he tends to talk about Swift and Sheridan, Goldsmith, people like that. He doesn't talk much about monastic Ireland, these manuscripts like this. Now, Joyce, just a few years after Yeats, is in a different branch, from my reading anyway, a different branch of the Irish literary tradition, continued today by voices like Seamus Heaney. Well, until the late Seamus Heaney. But so I want to introduce some Seamus Heaney stuff as we go along as well. And I guess what I mean by that is that one of the reasons I think it's hard for you to read that page is because the artist who did it brings a really charged sense of language to his mission. It almost doesn't matter what the page says in a traditional sense where we read a page. This is a page you don't read, you kind of look at it and you kind of experience it. Once we learn to read it, we realize maybe why it has to be this way. I mean, a standard paperback Bible or New Testament would be a lot easier to read, would make the point a lot more clearly. The story, I don't know why that damn thing keeps happening, but
it's gonna just keep happening.
I'll just keep tapping it, yeah. A standard pocketbook New Testament would do the job more efficiently, but efficiency isn't what's on the artist's mind here. He's dealing with, as he believes it anyway, the Word of God, as in the beginning was the Word. And so the book has to be a physically beautiful thing because of what it contains. Kind of in the same way that you could, I guess, say a Catholic Mass using a paper cup for a chalice, but the paper cup doesn't seem kind of worthy of what it's containing, if you follow me. So we use the gold, the chalice, the embroidery, the pageantry that goes with it. Even though technically speaking, the paper cup would do the job just as well. But there's something else going on here. And I want to suggest that as we learn to kind of get into it, to see what it's saying, we learn something about language, words, letters. We're all of different ages here. So we can also learn something about the acquisition of language, the acquisition of understanding of pages. I think maybe even more so in a digital age. After all, here I am talking about an ancient manuscript, probably from 800-900 AD, something like that, and I'm looking down at a laptop computer as the way to deal with it, as the way to experience it. So there's something kind of exciting going on just in that sort of contradiction. Now, I think Joyce, when he came along, looked to the Irish tradition embodied, say, by Yeats and people like that, the Anglo-Irish tradition, and felt resistance to it. We can see it in Joyce's works like The Dead, where Gabriel Conroy, the main character in that story, is told he should go to the Aran Islands and study Irish. And instead, he's looking in the other direction. He's looking to the continent, you know, rather than to Ireland. And there's something of James Joyce himself, and kind of an ironic portrait of Joyce, in the figure of Gabriel Conroy in The Dead, those of you who might know that story. But if you know other James Joyce works, the very first page of his very first story, The Sisters, is a young boy coming to grips with lots of things, but one of them is words. His friend the priest has suffered a stroke and he's suffering from paralysis. And the young narrator thinks that's an interesting word, and he's curious to go and look at it, almost as though he's looking at the word paralysis rather than at the paralyzed priest. You know, he's already started to abstract the word from what it might mean. It's actually a nice sounding word, paralysis. And there's a kind of conflict between what it sounds like and what it means. Many years later, I don't know if Archibald MacLeish, the poet, knew this, was making this connection, but the poet was talking to a group of students like this, and asked them about the meaning of poetry. And somebody said, well, that's the poetry is putting beautiful words together. And MacLeish said, no, that's not good at all, because some of the most beautiful words aren't very useful to the poet. And he offered, for example, syphilis. It's a beautiful word, you know, syphilis. There's not much you can do with it, though, you know. You're kind of stuck with that conflict between the word. And I think the sense of dislocation with language was crucial to Joyce. He came at a time within living memory of the Great Famine, which decimated not only Ireland's population, but along the way, because of the way it worked, it decimated the language. He was aware that the language he was writing in was a kind of an inherited language. It wasn't his native language. He didn't even really know his native language. And that sense of dislocation is present very early in Joyce and goes right through the end to Finnegan's Wake, where I don't expect you to have read or to ever read, maybe, Finnegan's Wake. It's one of the great unread books in the history of literature. But it's in Finnegan's Wake, I'll show you this in some excerpts later, that Joyce acknowledges his debt to the Book of Kells. So can we begin by trying to read this page? Some of you who have studied this page might know it, and you can see at the top it's Cairo, the Cairo page, so it's the Greek Chi and the Greek Rho, okay? Those of you who are fraternity, sorority people would recognize some of that stuff. So I would say that from Joyce's point of view, what you see there are really three language traditions kind of struggling with each other on the page. You have the Greek, okay? But the Book of Kells is actually a Latin transcription of the New Testament. That's what the Book of Kells is, if you didn't know. It's an 8th, 9th century manuscript associated with the monastery at Kells. That's why they call it the Book of Kells. And it's a Latin transcription of the New Testament. It's beginning here with three letters from the Greek. The third element that's there is the Celtic imagination of the artist. And that Celtic imagination, as I would put it, and I think Joyce and Heaney would say the same thing, is grounded in an earlier tradition of saga, mythology, embodied in the ancient Irish texts, a pagan, pre-Christian worldview. So what you have here, in my reading, is a Christian text that can't be changed. After all, you can't offer a new version of the New Testament. You get in trouble that way. You know what I mean? You can't change the ending. So you're kind of hamstrung by the text. The story is what it is. You know, you can't uncrucify Jesus. You can't tell it unless you want to do a Mel Gibson movie or something. You have to stick with the story as it is on the page. It's fixed. But around the words, you can let your imagination free. So I think a couple of linguistic and religious traditions are in tension here, which is what gives the page its beauty and its energy. These are the first letters of the word Christ, Christus. Chiro, okay? C-H-R-I, Christus, Christ. The big swirling X you see, you can see the P and the I here, okay? You can see a kind of playfulness, maybe. Oh, I don't know quite what to say of it. In the P, which ends with the head of a man, a lot of this reminds me of the kind of drawings you sometimes see from my grandchildren. A lot of it reminds me in some ways of doodling. Students doodle on the page all the time. A lot of what's most interesting on a student's note page is the doodling, not the geometry notes or the philosophy notes, but the doodling in the margins, the drawings, the circles, the lines, the interconnections, etc. Okay, so we have to learn to read it by looking very carefully. I think that's true. Now, the reason, and I think it's very modern, although it's 800 AD. How many of you have had the experience of going to a modern art museum and looking at the canvas and say, "What the hell is that?" It's not speaking to you in the usual narrative frame that you're used to when you look at painting. It's not naturalistic. It's not representational. It's something else is going on the canvas that you need to kind of learn to appreciate. If you read Joyce's Ulysses, you have to learn your way into the text. It's a complicated text. There's lots of things going on at once, things bouncing off each other. I'll see if I can master this computer. So that's the Cairo page.
Show us the head, Jim.
Huh?
Show us the head. With your pointer.
With my pointer, this guy here, see him there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you see this big swirling X dominates the page. The P, the I, okay, so Cairo. I don't know if you can make it out, but there's a couple of angels here. Okay? There's a third angel up here. Basically, on these pages, you get animals, foliage, human representations, abstract geometric shapes, which are certainly a very modern thing. If you think of modern painting, okay, there's a lot of abstraction of just pure form here. And yet, hidden in all that maybe initial chaos that you see is the beginning of a story, okay? And because the Cairo page is associated with the birth of Christ, to the artist or artists, we're not quite sure if there's one artist here or multiple artists on a given page, he would approach this page with real trepidation almost. You know, am I worthy of putting this on the page somehow? Or is the subject just too, it's almost like, do I have the courage to even hold a chalice in my hand, you know, given what it's supposed to represent? Or isn't that in itself kind of overwhelming, you know? I'm not worthy. Lord, I am not worthy. Isn't that what we say at a Catholic Mass? I'll move it along here. My plan is to maybe talk to you for 45 minutes or thereabouts, an hour, at which point we take a break, because some of you are in a class here, and some of you just popped in for this portion of the lecture. So we'll take a break and then we can split up as we see fit, and so those in the class, we can keep going with more questions and answers or whatever. So I don't want to delay too long on any one page. I'm going to try to move along here if I can figure out how to do it. This is Murphy goes to, I'm doing the wrong button. I'm going to give you a poem here by Seamus Heaney, I'm screwing it up already.
Yeah, it's up there.
Is it up there?
Yeah.
No, that's not it. No, that's...
Scroll up.
I want to go back to number one. I see this here. Is it?
Yeah, go the other way.
Okay. Now, Seamus Heaney just passed away a few years ago, and I'm trying to place him in the context of Book of Kells, scribes, monastic scribes, writing, letters, linguistic tensions, and in his case, in this poem, kind of excavating You may or may not know that the Book of Kells itself had to be dug up. It's not quite sure why it was buried, but it was buried, they best estimate, for probably 200 or 300 years, maybe initially because of the Elizabethan conquest and the destruction of the monasteries, that sacred things were protected as best they could. There's, as you may know, if you've been to the National Museum in Ireland, almost all the old artifacts you see in the National Museum of Ireland, it'll say at the bottom, dug up by a farmer in County Tipperary, dug up by this, dug up by somebody. So the act of digging up things is the act of archaeology, but from Heaney's point of view, it's also the act of writing. So there's a connection between those two things. You see the opening line between my finger and my thumb, the squat pen rests snug as a gun. We won't go into all of the ramifications of the gun image for a poet from Northern Ireland, but there is that point here that for him, the way you dig, I'll look at the last two stanzas here. The cold smell of potato mold, the squelch and slap of soggy peat, the curt cuts of an edge through living roots awaken in my head. But I've no spade to follow men like them. Between my finger and my thumb, the squat pen rests, I'll dig with it. So that notion that you use the pen to dig, the pen to get at, as we say, the bottom of things. And if you know much about Seamus Heaney's poems, there's a lot of it involved digging, and a lot of the digging that goes on in Ireland is the digging in bogs, in turf, and turf, as you may know, is a great preservative. If you've seen those bodies in the National Museum in Ireland, they're not skeletons, they're preserved, you know, they don't look great, but they're preserved because the bog is a preserver of history. The Book of Kells gets dug up, okay? It's only dug up and be brought to the attention of Irish people, even, roughly 50 years or so before James Joyce comes on the scene. So it's an old book, but buried for a long, long, long time in either physical burial or just the burial of forgetfulness. A lot of the Irish literature that we study here, 20th century Irish literature, is under the title, the Irish Revival or the Irish Renaissance. That is, something is being reborn, something has been rediscovered that had been lost for a long, long time. And when it's rediscovered, it seems almost brand new because you haven't known it. So the sagas, everybody's talking about the Iliad and the Odyssey. No. There's the Tawn. There's Cuchulainn instead of Achilles. You know, we have our own epic heroes. We have our own, and from Joyce's point of view, great work of art, not the great canvases of the Louvre, but a book. Okay? A book. Let me get it back here. Okay, let's go through some more stuff here for you, if I can. Okay, how do I do this, Tina? Get up here.
It's a bug. Just say don't save again.
Don't save, right? There you go, okay. Right. Another page for you to read, okay? This is... I'm going to try to go back and forth between pages of the Book of Kells, Joyce, Heaney, back and forth to try to show a continuity, okay? So I'll jump, and that'll work with the audience maybe, because some of you are interested in the Joyce part of it, some of you in the art history part of it. So we'll try to keep you all happy. This is the first word of the Gospel of St. Luke. First words of these Gospels get special attention for obvious reasons, okay? This word is quoniam. Quoniam, just an adverb, not an important word. It's not like Cairo, Christ, you know. It's just an adverb, for God's sake. But it is the first word of the gospel, therefore it's an important word. So what it means is almost nothing. It's just a lousy adverb, okay? But the artist puts all of this imaginative energy into this one word, okay? Quoniam. I don't know if you can read it, but clearly language in this sense is not on a linear horizontal plane, Okay, the word quoniam is up there, and I'll kind of show it to you in a minute, but in the meantime, you can try to search it out. You have to use a whole different sense of what letters look like, what letters mean. Okay? Basically, if I walk you through it, this whole great big thing here is Q, okay? U is the shape of a V. You follow it? O. Q-U-O-N. See it? T-E-N. I-A-M. Quoniam. Okay? You still don't see it, right? I'll give you a detail that might help you out in a minute, but that's a Q-U-O-N-I-A-M. Quoniam. Okay? Quoniam. The I like the I, because somehow when I look at it, it reminds me of the kid's toy they used to have called Gumby. You know that toy? Like a rubber guy, you could shape him any way you wanted. That's quoniam. Let me give you a detail of that to help you out here. Okay, now you can see maybe better. N I A M. Gumby, that's his name, isn't it? Quoniam. Okay. Now, here. Now that you've got some sense of two pages, this is from Finnegan's Wake. Some quotes from Joyce. The speaker here is looking at a manuscript that's been dug up from a dung heap. It's very obviously the Book of Kells that Joyce is talking about, okay? And he's talking, in fact, about the edition that he had. Let me give you a quote here before I look at that, for a quote that's not on the screen, but I'll tell you here. This is a quote from the biography of Joyce by Richard Ellman. It says, when Joyce's friend Arthur Power confessed to Joyce that he would like to write but didn't know how to proceed. Students have that interest all the time, right? Joyce urged him to study the Book of Kells. He told Power, and this quote from Joyce now, in all the places I have been to, Rome, Zurich, Trieste, I have taken it about with me and have pored over its workmanship for hours. It is the most purely Irish thing we have. That's the phrase that first caught my attention when I came upon it in Finnegan's Wake, and that led me back to the Book of Kells and to this whole, what the hell did he mean? The most purely Irish thing we have. He didn't say the most purely Christian thing we have. It's the most purely Irish thing we have. And some of the big letters which swing right across a page, we've seen some of them, have the essential quality of a chapter of Ulysses. Indeed, you can compare much of my work to the intricate illuminations. I would like it to be possible to pick up any page of my book and know at once what book it is. That would certainly be true of Ulysses or of Finnegan's Wake, for sure. These are quotes from Finnegan's Wake. The speaker is looking at this strange book, okay? And look what he says. No, so help me, Petolta, it is not a miseffectual, oh boy, it is not a miseffectual, why a synthonous riot of blots and blurs and bars and balls and hoops and wiggles and juxtaposed jottings linked by spurts of speed? It only looks as like as damn it. And sure, we ought really to rest thankful that at this deleteful hour of dung flies dawning, we have even a written on with dried ink scrap of paper at all to show for ourselves, tear it or leaf it. After all that we lost and plundered of it, even to the hindmost coinings of the earth, and all it has gone through, and by all means, after a good ground kiss to Terracusa, and for war's luck, our left us flung over our home, homoplate, cling to it with drowning hands, hoping against all hope all the while, that by the light of philosophy, and may she never false age us, things will begin to clear up a bit one way or another, within the next quarrel of an hour. So I hope that'll be true of us today. Things will begin to clear up a bit within the next quarrel of an hour. It's just a few more shorter quotes, but you get the feel for what he's saying about language, letters, alphabets, words, etc. Stoop if you are ABCED minded to this clay book. What curios of signs, please stoop in this aleph bed. Can you read, since we and thou had it out already, its world? And not its word, but its world. When a part so petite does duty for the holos, we soon grow to use of it all for a bit. That's alphabet, of course, and all for a bit. Here, please to stoop, are silver and cued petite peas of a quite pecuniary interest. And we've seen a few petite peas of pecuniary interest. So you need hardly spell me how every word will be bound over to carry 60 top typical readings throughout the book of Dublin's Gind. So those are all comments about the Book of Kells by Joyce. Now we go to another page, really beautiful page here. This is the opening of John's Gospel. Whoopsie daisy, I messed it up. Oh, Jesus. Sorry. John's Gospel. There, I think I got it now. You should be good enough now, as Joyce said. Can you read its world? Can you read that one? It's the most pecuniary P. If you know the first words of John's Gospel in the Latin, you all probably know them in English. In principio erat verbum et verbum. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made flesh. Okay? In the beginning was the Word. Now, Jesus, how could Joyce not resist that? In the beginning was the Word. You know? In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was made flesh. Interestingly enough, the Book of Kells, they estimate to make the pages of the Book of Kells, it took about the skins of about 150, 160 calves to make the calf skin pages. So that is literally the Word made flesh. The Book of Kells is actually flesh, unlike these pages here, which you take, you just throw the damn things away, right? It's so disposable. But in this case, the page, physically the page, is precious. It's precious. Now, if you look around, let's try to follow this here if we can, okay? In, you see in. I, right? Then the N, that's part of the I, N. Okay? So far, so good? This part of the N forms part of the P. In prin, I'll show you a detail to help you there. Can you see it? R-I-N? R-I-N. C-I. I'll show you a detail of that in a minute. C-I. In prin, chi, P-O, P-I-O, okay? In chipio, erat, E-R-A-T, and then you get verbum et verbum. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made flesh. In principio. Once again, obviously, conveying the narrative was not the mission of the artist here. He wanted the splendor of the concept. Like I said before, a paperback New Testament would do the job a lot better if you just wanted to say, in the beginning was the Word. But when you want to celebrate the whole concept of that, it's not just the Word, but the letter, the very letters of the Word are sacred, okay? I think I can give you a detail that might help you out. A detail I particularly like because there's a certain playfulness about the artists here. This is the R-I-N, okay? In prin, okay? See the R-I-N? And the C-I, C, that's what I really like. The I is actually a human figure, and the C then becomes a harp. You see that? So you have the wonderful image of the music that's conveyed in the concept of in the beginning was the word. Principio erat verbum et verbum. Now, where am I going? Let's see here. I'll go back to Seamus Heaney. And again, especially for the younger people in the audience, or even for the older ones, because we're lucky enough to have grandchildren now. I didn't notice it so much with my own kids, maybe because they were too busy worrying about things. I don't know what it was. But the process of learning words, the process of acquiring language, I've taken it away. Some of you, if you're in a regular classroom now, not in a place like this, but a regular classroom with a desk, you probably have a pen in your hand. In the old-fashioned way, anyway, to take notes, you know. But do you remember how hard it was to learn how to hold a goddamn pen? Yeah. You ever watch, if you watch little kids, they send you a note, you know. They hold a pen like this. You know? And they try to make a P for pop-pop, and it comes out twisted and turned. And, you know, it's all kinds of stuff. So the process of acquiring some control over language, which is a big deal in early James Joyce. In Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, Stephen Dedalus is one of his favorite books in grade school is the spelling book. Because in the spelling book, the words are just words. And some words he likes better than others. Suck was a queer word. And a belt was to give a fellow a belt with. He's playing with these words all the time, juggling them, which kids do. Kids are great for juggling words, rhyming, you know, just playing with words before somehow, I don't know where in seventh grade the nuns tell you to get that word right or else, you know, and you get afraid of language. But when you're a little kid, you love language and you just play around with it. And even when you're drawing pictures or whatever, you have a certain freedom that seems to diminish maybe as you get older a little bit. This is Heaney's version of that in the poem Alphabets. It's a multi-part poem. The second part here deals with, Heaney was private school as Joyce did, so they learned Latin early, you know? So Latin was part of their framework, mainly for religious reasons. You know, the Mass was in Latin at the time. And then there's also English, which is the language you speak. You live in Northern Ireland, so you're British, but you're Irish. You're not quite sure how this all adds up when you're a youngster. Even if you're an adult, you don't know how it all adds up. But what's your language? And even what is your calligraphy? And we're learning how to make letters, you know? An A is a tent with a line across, you know? An H is like a bridge. And you learn these kinds of ways of acquiring control over letters, just letters by themselves. So this here poem deals with that. Now, the old Irish alphabet, I'm talking now about pre-Celtic stuff, okay? Written down from the old Irish by monks who knew Latin. Talk about how screwed up they were, okay? And their monks, in a rather strict, cloistered, monastic world, writing down texts about all kinds of wild sexual behavior in ancient Ireland. Talk about wild stuff. The alphabet of the old Irish language comes from the names of trees. Trees, okay? And the Druids, as we call them, you know, who we associate as the wise men of ancient Ireland, met in some places anyway in the oak grove. The oak being sacred, the oak grove, the Irish grove. The oak is the name of the present city of Derry, okay? D-O-I-R-E, Dor. but it's Derry, is the oak grove. Seamus Heaney is from County Derry. Okay? So the connection of me, Seamus Heaney, Northern Irelander, with ancient Irish scribes, okay, and me acquiring and controlling a language as a poet has to do, I think has some of the same tension that I'm trying to say to you goes on in the artists of the Book of Kells, if that makes sense. Maybe that's too big a leap, I don't know. He says here, declension sang on air like a hosanna, as column after stratified column, book one of Elementa Latina, marbled and minatory, rose up in him. For he was fostered next in a stricter school, named for the patron saint of the oak wood. And we do know that in ancient Ireland, children were fostered out for learning purposes, okay? So aunts, uncles, whatever. Somebody in the family tree would take control of the child and foster the child. Heaney went away to boarding school as a young boy. So that's his version of being fostered out. He's not at home. He's in this other place where he learns Latin, say. And he left the Latin Forum for the shade of new calligraphy that felt like home. The letters of this alphabet were trees. The capitals were orchards in full bloom, the lines of script coiled in ditches. Here in her snooted garment and bare feet, all ringleted in assonance and wood notes, the poet's dream stole over him like sunlight and passed into the tenebrous thickets. He learns this other writing. He is the scribe who drove a team of quills on his white field. That's another image Heaney comes back to all the time, is the way we use the word field. I might say that to the students here. They say, you're going to go into medical school. I say, oh, yeah, what field are you going to do? You know, pediatrician, what's your field? It's a nice metaphor reminding us that there was a time when everybody worked in the field. Certainly in Ireland, to labor was to be in a field, you know. Going back to digging. Remember digging at what I started off with? Digging, same thing here. Heaney has a lovely poem, I didn't include it here, called Follower, when he talks about being on his father's shoulders, you know, piggyback, as his father drove a team this way, you know, through the field, planting, and looking back and realizing how perfect the lines were, you know. And what did they remind him of? The page, the lines on a page. If you see the lines, think of flying over a farm from, if you're up in 3,000 feet, you know, you look down and you can see that a page, physically just a page of straight text looks a bit maybe like a field. He learns this other writing. He is the scribe who drove a team of quills on his white field. Round his cellar door, the blackbirds dart and dab. Then self-denial, fasting the pure cold. This is a Heaney theme that comes up, that in the monastic world, there was this tension between the natural glories all around them in the Irish landscape. You know, the sea, if you know, particularly the west of Ireland, is wildly beautiful, matched up with a kind of monastic tightness, you know, that there'd be a tension in that monastic world between the two gods calling out to the artists or to the monks, and the rules that hardened the farther they reached north. He bends to his desk and begins again. Christ's sickle has been in the undergrowth. The script grows bare and Merovingian. Let me go move along here. It's a lovely poem. It's a longer poem. So this, by the way, is the first page of one of the early editions of Joyce's Ulysses. Remember how he said that some of his pages would remind you of the pages of Ulysses? This is the first page of Ulysses. Stately, plump Buck Mulligan, and on the text goes. But three of the pages in the book have these great big swirling letters, which then mark the book into three kind of separate divisions. And Joyce was very kind of anal even about how his books looked. You know, he wanted them to look a certain way, and he was very careful about publishers and things like that. Talk about linguistic confusion. Joyce writes Ulysses, a very difficult book. It's in English, but it's in an English that fractures many of the rules. And the book is set into type by Frenchmen who don't know English at all. And Joyce deliberately includes in Ulysses especially lots of misspellings, puns, as part of his use of language. That language is uncertain. It never quite means what it looks like it means. Okay? Stephen Dedalus receives a telegram, another dying, come home father, mother. But the telegram says another. He keeps it in his pocket. He's this interesting misspelling, mother, another. typesetter, oh, this should obviously be mother. So the typesetter fixes it up for Mr. Joyce, which drives Joyce crazy, of course. He wants the misspelling. He wants the language to be unsettled, you know. You can't be sure of it. And this is the first page of Molly Bloom's soliloquy, which is the last chapter of Ulysses. It's about 35 pages long. It's unpunctuated. You might say to yourself, well, I'm just going to read to the end of this sentence. Well, you'll be there a long time before you get to the end of the sentence. You see, you can just begin reading it and you can see. I deliberately left the scribble in the margin because that itself reminded me of the Book of Kells. But you can see there's no punctuation. It just runs along. Okay, it's crowded with all kinds of stuff going on in it. Matthew, go back to the Book of Kells. Matthew's Gospel, okay. Liber, in Latin, liber generationes. Liber as in book, library, right? Liberal arts, okay. Liberal. Liber, the book of the genealogy of Christ, Liber Generationes. You might be able to read a little bit of it. I'll try to show you here. L, I, B, okay? In the middle of the B, it's E-R, okay? Liber. The Generationes doesn't really even show up on this. But it's down at the very bottom, and it is actually the word. You can actually read that one. Move along here. A detail. This is the upper right corner. These figures, usually the figures, they say the figure is usually the scribe himself or the evangelist. Or sometimes both. This particular page, if I went back to it, has two human figures. So, or one of them could be the abbot of the monastery or something like that. If I go back to that one, you see he seems to be, the word says Liber, book, and the figure here seems to be offering a book, or bringing a book. Now you have the scribes themselves. The original scribes, of course, aren't the monks, but the four evangelists. They're the scribes. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but they've all been transformed, okay? Matthew is the man. Mark is the lion. John is the eagle. And Luke is a calf. Okay, and the four evangelists. Then the scribes from the monastic period, these are some poems that will give you a flavor for. Now, a lot of these poems. On the kind of pages I'm showing you from the Book of Kells, they're the really important pages, you know, the first pages or the birth of Christ or something like that. But then there's tons and tons of just text. And a lot of the monastic books aren't the New Testament. They're simply business, you know, copying before the age of Xerox and everything else. It's just history, whatever it might be. It gets boring. So a lot of the little poems that we treasure from ancient Ireland or monastic Ireland are marginalia. again, like student doodling. You know, they're in the margins of things. And they are also things that have only been kind of recently unearthed. And many of them have a remarkably modern feel to them. They're particularly some of them reminiscent of haiku. You know, and the way imagist poets in the 20th century went for things like William Carlos's Williams' Red Wheelbarrow, if you know that little poem. You know, so much depends upon a red wheelbarrow beside the rainwater and the yellow chickens or something like that. And that's it. It's over. So here you have a wall of woodland overlooks me. A blackbird sings me a song, no lie. Above my book, with its lines laid out, the birds and their music sing to me. The cuckoo sings clear and lovely voice in his gray cloak from a bushy fort. I swear it now, but God is good. It is lovely writing out in the wood. you can see in that the tension maybe between the scribe's job, which is copying, okay, and the world outside his cell, which is glorious with bird song and things blooming, things like that. So he's pulled in two directions. Maybe you'd want to take a day off, you know, have a snow day. This next one is very haiku-ish. How lovely it is today. The sunlight breaks and flickers on the margin of my book. But they're always doing something with the book, you know? A bird is calling from the willow with lovely beak, a clean call, sweet yellow tip. He is black and strong. It is doing a dance, the blackbird's song. This next thing reminds me a little bit of an abstract painting almost. The little bird lets out a whistle from his beak, tip bright yellow. He sends the note across Loch Leg, a blackbird, a branch, a mass of yellow. I can almost picture that as an abstract painting of yellow and black. Let me see what I have next here. Oh, more of the same. Because you want to say to yourself, who are these guys, these scribes? What were they like? What was their world like? And these are a few talking again about, you see the date, early 9th century. This would be around the same time as the illustrations of the Book of Kells. A hedge before me, one behind, a blackbird sings from that. Above my small book, many lined, I apprehend his chat. Up trees in costumes, buff, mild, accurate cuckoos bleat. Lord love me, good the stuff I write in a shady seat. But then maybe sometimes those of you who write, for whatever reason, you might relate to this next one from the 11th century. My hand has a pain from writing. Not steady the sharp tool of my craft. Remember Heaney's poem, between my thumb and finger the squat pen rests, and in the alphabet's poem, learning to make new calligraphy and all that. The tool of my craft. Remember, too, that these monks made their ink. The pages were of the Book of Kells, really important books, were calfskin, okay? But the ink itself was natural forms from plants, herbs. You had to make your own ink. Okay? So you were constantly reminded of the relationship of your art to the natural world around you. Second stanza, streams of wisdom of white God from my fair brown fine hand Sally. On the page they splash their flood in ink of the green-skinned holly. My little dribbly pen stretches across the great white paper plain, insatiable for splendid riches. That is why my hand has pain. those translations are by the Irish novelist Flann O'Brien. Some of you may know the work of Flann O'Brien, who is very much influenced by James Joyce. So, move along here. I have one more gospel to get you through. The opening words of Mark's gospel. Okay, by now you should be able to read this. Latin. The opening words of Mark's Gospel in Latin are initium, Initium, as in the beginning, you know, initium. Evangelii, as in gospel, a gospel, beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Initium, Evangelii, the Jesus Christ is down here, you see? That XPI again, Cairo, you see it? There, okay? Okay. Now how about initium? I. N, I, right? So the I, N, I is all the same structure, basically. Initium, the T and the I are one. Okay, the T and then the I is part of the T. Initium. Okay. Evan, E-V-A-N. G-E. Jelly, L-I-I-I here. And then the beginning of Jesus Christ. Beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'll show you a detail so you get a look at this character up top here. He's an interesting fellow. Well, it's just the detail of the letters. This is the E-V-A-N, okay? G-E, okay? Evangelii of Jesus Christ, okay? And or see all the ornate stuff. There's no such thing as empty space here. No such thing as empty space. This is the fellow up at the top there. It's quite hard to figure out exactly what he's doing, what's going on there. One hand is braiding his beard. Can you see that? Even his beard has become part of this elaborate geometric thing. His other hand reaches down here, if you follow me, and grabs the tongue of this creature here. Now, whether he's subduing that creature or what, you could only guess. I could only guess how to interpret that. But these are the kinds of images in the margins that Joyce found so fascinating. A Seamus Heaney poem in Gallerus Oratory. Gallerus Oratory, you may have seen it if you've been to Ireland. Kerry. Not quite sure when it dates from, but it's a monastic chapel or hut, probably the kind of place where one would worship, perhaps the kind of place where one would do important work, you know, maybe copying books and things there. And Heaney is emphasizing again that there are two religious impulses pulling against this place. One is that if you've ever been there, it's remarkable. You walk into this, it's a bit like going into Newgrange if you've ever been there. It's kind of dark, gloomy, chilly. And you feel almost claustrophobic from the weight of the stones that you feel all around you, you know. Maybe the whole thing's the size of this room, maybe a little less. And then you come out, and these mountain ranges are there. The sea is there. You know how if you're a Catholic, when you go into a church, you go into your pew, you do this, you know, you kneel down. Catholic masses, you're always kneeling down saying you're sorry, for God's sakes. You know, you're always kneeling down, I am not worthy, I am not worthy. But then you come out, so it's the different impulses to go down and genuflect, and the other is to jump up and celebrate. You can still feel the community pack this place. It's like going into a turf stack, a core of old dark walled up with stone a yard thick. When you're in it alone, you might have dropped a reduced creature to the heart of the globe. No worshiper would leap up to his God off this floor. Founded there like heroes in a barrow, they sought themselves in the eye of their king, under the black weight of their own breathing. And how he smiled on them as out they came, the sea a censer and the grass a flame. a censer is the incense boat that priests use it in masses where they're using incense. Almost done now here, and then I can wind it up for you. I don't have a watch on, so I don't know if I'm talking too long or not.
You're fine.
Okay. Never talk too long.
Thank you, Jared. Thank you. I brought him along just for that.
He's looking for a good grade.
Yeah. Now, can you read this? Of course you can't. You can make out bits and pieces here and there, but you can't read it. And that's because it's a manuscript page from Joyce's Finnegan's Wake. Okay. Now, another thing about Joyce, which I won't go into too much here, maybe after if we take a break, of Joyce's connection to the book of... Joyce had terrible eyesight. Eyesight figures in his writings from very early on, with little Stephen Dedalus breaking his glasses, you know, and being punished for not doing his homework because he broke his glasses. And he had at least 7 major eye operations and other treatments, including things like leeches applied to the eyes to try to cure. He was basically blind at the end of his life. But when he was writing both Ulysses and Finnegan's Wake, particularly, his eyes were deteriorating badly. And he was using microscopes, everything, and his handwriting was terrible. So he talks in Finnegan's Wake about his kinship to these monastic scribes whose eyes must have always hurt them because of all the little details that they were working on. I hope you saw those pages of the Book of Kells. A page of the Book of Kells is maybe like that. It's not the size of the screen, you know. It's a smallish page. To have all of that in it would be very, very difficult on your eyes. So this is just a page from Finnegan's Wake. You see there are some geometrical type drawings there, things like that. These are just 2 more pages. He must have changed his mind a few times about what he liked or didn't like. And another one. So how would you like to be the typesetter for that manuscript? And some of you know about this because the manuscript for Ulysses is down in the Rosenbach Museum in Philadelphia, so you might have actually seen that. So there you go. That's my presentation for today. You could hit the light back on, Tina, and take any questions that people might have. I don't know what time it is. Tina, where are we?
Good.
We're okay.
It's a good thing.
Well, now some of you are here as part of a class. I know that. So some of you aren't. And so those of you who aren't, you have a hall pass. You can leave. Russ, you had a question. Russ?
You mentioned that James Joyce called the Book of Kells the most purely Irish thing.
Yeah.
Was that part of the text of Finnegan's Wake?
No. No, that was
something
that he said in a letter.
In relation to his writing.
I'm not sure if I understand you there, but that phrase appears in a letter he wrote to his friend Arthur Power. Power had asked him, what should I read to learn how to be a good writer? You know, normally you'd say Shakespeare or something like that. Joyce said, study the Book of Kells, by which he must surely have meant, he doesn't say what he meant, that something about his concept of language is what will teach you to be a good writer. That's how I read it anyway. And so what does he mean by most purely Irish thing we have? I think it's because in the Book of Kells he saw the same kind of conflict of aesthetic forces that he felt himself as an Irishman in a country that had just recently lost its language, working in a new language. If you're a writer, the thing that's most important to you as a writer is words, ultimately the words. Anybody who does any writing, you know, the idea isn't the hard part. It's getting the idea down on the page in the right words or in the right form. I mean, we know what the idea kind of takes care of itself, you know, the concept. So I think that's what he meant, a purely Irish thing we have, that to be Irish for Joyce in that time and probably into today, same for Seamus Heaney, from Northern Ireland and all the political ramifications of that, that to be Irish lives to live in a kind of conflicted state of linguistic and cultural identity. One of the most important symbolic Irish, contemporary Irish writers is the writer Nuala Ní Gonal. If you know her name at all, Nuala Ní Gonal, she writes all of her stuff in Irish. And in doing so, she's making obviously a statement. She's also making a great, she doesn't even translate her stuff. She gets other people to translate her stuff into English. Okay? If she's going to sell any books, they have to be in English. Okay? She knows she's working in a language that's barely alive. She taught here for a semester in the early days of the Heimbold chair. She was, I think, maybe the second person we had, or third. And usually these people teach a course in creative writing, you know? So I said to her, Nuala, well, one of your courses will be creative writing, the other one could be a literature course. And she said, no. I couldn't teach creative writing in English. All my creative writing thinking is in Irish. Okay. Now, writers like Seamus Heaney, other great contemporary Irish writers, are frequent translators of Nuala Ní Gonal's work, you know, which helps give that work status, but it's also a recognition on their part that in some ways they are not writing in the language that defines them. They're writing in the language that came with political conquest. That, I think, is an interesting part of the Irish identity that you can translate back to America and other places where people undergo a cultural shift. I mean, the Irish lose their language without emigrating. They stay at home and lose their language. That's pretty rare. Sometimes you lose it by emigrating. And one generation, two generations, the third generation, nobody's speaking Italian anymore. They're eating pasta, but they don't speak Italian. I say, lots of times in class, I say, how many of you students are Italian? And five hands go up. You ask them, say something in Italian. I can't do that. I thought you were Italian. So in doing that, I was trying to get them to think about this linguistic component to one's cultural identity. And if you go to Ireland, you know, you see it. They're confused about all this. That is, the street signs are in Irish. You know, the names of the towns are Irish English. Most everybody's speaking English all the time. Very few people speak Irish, but they take it in school in the same way that maybe you took introductory Spanish in high school or something, you know. But it's only in rare parts of Ireland that Irish is a living language, and even there it's barely living, you know, and they would be places furthest removed from the anglicized world of the rest of Ireland. But people don't want to give it up, you know. I mean, Joyce says, I'll take the English language and I'll show them how to use it. So,
and he did.
He did. But he did it by fracturing it and putting it back together in different ways, you know what I mean? The character Bloom, who is himself displaced in Ulysses, he's a Hungarian Jewish extraction, okay, living in Dublin. And among other things, in his wanderings around the city that day, he's in the newspaper office, and he's watching them set type. And he's interested in the way everything is typed in reverse. Now, this is a different way of reading, when everything is typed in reverse, and yet when it comes out in the newspaper, it's back the other way. So that language is kind of always in flux. It's not a fixed thing. You know, we grow up thinking language is fixed. We learned how to diagram sentences as though it's a mathematical precision, you know, to language, but it's actually much more fluid. I actually like that in what I know, a little bit I know, of rap music. There's a certain fluency with language there, playfulness with language, outside the box use of language, you know, it's not so tight-assed. You follow what I mean, Ross? If you're copying down the Word of God in the New Testament, like I say, you can't change it. Your imagination is kind of in a straitjacket, but at the same time, the margins set you free. It's in the margins you can do what you really want to do. All this crazy stuff that's going on, playful sometimes. Who knows what it's all about sometimes? But it's not the actual text that matters. The text has almost been forgotten because you can't find it. You go looking for it and you can't find it. Yeah, Tina, you.
I'm just thinking that when they first started to do these books, they didn't know Latin either.
That's true. Yeah.
They're pretty much preliterate until.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
They have to start recording that.
Yeah.
So for them, it's like fake from the very beginning.
You know, even St. Patrick's Week, right? The most purely Irish thing we have, right? We're stuck in American St. Patrick's Day celebrations with green beer and Irish potatoes and all this other crap as being Irish, you know? I mean, I think Joyce is right. The Book of Kells is the most purely Irish thing we have. Forget the shamrocks and shillelaghs, you know? Let's look at something that actually drives us into the culture. As difficult as that might be, Tina.
Did Joyce ever?
I was going to say St. Patrick himself embodies this kind of dislocation, right? He's a Romanized Brit. Mm. He's a Romanized Brit coming to Celtic Ireland with this new religion, trying to impose it on people whose their literature suggests they have wild beliefs and wild social habits. You know, and here he comes with this new gospel. Now, it takes one of Ireland's blessings, I guess, blessing or curse, I don't know how you look at it, but it's physical isolation, you know what I mean? It's at the ass end of Europe. So a lot of the forces that reshaped Christianity on the continent under the influence of Rome didn't come across to Ireland. So Ireland, the Christianity that we see in these pages is very different from what you see in the same periods on the continent. On the continent, it's what they call the Dark Ages. They used to call the Dark Ages in the old history books. It's a glorious period in Ireland with this monastic excitement going on. It's partly, again, because of its isolation. The Romans got as far as Britain, right? The Romans got as far as Britain. They built wonderful aqueducts and things like that. They looked across the Irish Sea, they said, the hell with it, for whatever reason. They didn't, it's too far, the people there are crazy, there's no resources, it's cold, it rains too much, who knows why. The weather wasn't very Roman, you know. So only very, very marginal influence from the Romanizing of Europe, really. So Celtic Christianity is quite different from Roman Christianity. And it's one of the ironies of this, again, everything's so ironic in Irish history, that it's the Pope, the only English Pope ever, okay, Adrian IV, the only English Pope ever, who gave Henry II the title Lord of Ireland. He said, go over there and straighten those bastards out. Because the Irish church was kind of doing its own thing. It was this wild combination of Christianity and nature religion. I don't think that's ever changed. I think I'm rethinking of my recent plays like Brian Friel's Dancing at Lunasa, if you know that play, made into a movie with Meryl Streep, okay? Where you get this Christianity, but tied in with this festival of Lunasa, worshiping of ancient gods. I've been in Ireland for June 22nd, the eve of the Feast of St. John, bonfires burning everywhere, okay? It has nothing to do with St. John. It has something to do with pagan rituals of the summer solstice, you know, the longest day of the year and all that. Even in my own house growing up, my mother was devoutly Catholic, real devout Catholic, but she also believed in ghosts and fairies and She lived a dual religious life. You know, one was straight Catholic, the other was kind of hocus pocus, and they existed side by side, as I think happens in the Book of Kells too, side by side. Yeah.
Obviously, the Book of Kells exists at Trinity College.
Yeah.
But over the centuries, how did it get saved? I mean, why wasn't it just thrown out? I mean,
well,
who saved it?
Well, part of it was buried.
Sure.
It was buried for a long time, yeah.
Well,
they say in the monastery at Kells, but there's no proof of that, you know. It's not clear if it was even done at Kells. It was given to, I think it was in the 17th century. It was given to Trinity, along with a whole bunch of other things. Mm-hmm. And for the first 200 years, they didn't realize what they had. They didn't know exactly what it was. you know, put it in the corner. And in fact, suffered a lot of damage, apparently, and some pages went missing and stuff like that. So, and then there were a few times, this happens, I guess, to artifacts all the time, when people try to fix them up. In the process of fixing them up, they mess them up more than they...
So then how did it become this great symbol?
I think in 1950s is when the Book of Kells first began being exhibited. And I don't know, again, I think of it as a great symbol of Ireland, but I think most of the world doesn't think of it that way. Most of the world thinks of shamrocks and shillelaghs, I think.
But Joyce?
Joyce knew of the Book of Kells. I have here, not Joyce's copy, but this is the book he had. It was first published, this is a 1926 edition, I think, but it was first published in 1914 by a commentary by Sir Edward Sullivan. And with that, those quotes I had from Finnegan's Wake, it is not a wiacinthinous riot of blots and blurs and all that. Those are all paraphrases of Sullivan's scholarship. So Joyce says two things. He talks about, and he says, I spent hours, took it with him wherever he went, pored over its workmanship for hours, which must have meant this kind of stuff. But he also studied the commentary of Sullivan very carefully. Okay? And Sullivan, now I don't know the history of reproductions, but Sullivan's introduction here says that this is the first time reproductions became available that were reasonably good approximations of the colors. That previously, maybe that's another reason why it wasn't appreciated. You know, nobody could see it. And whatever reproductions were done probably weren't very good, almost black and white maybe, though I haven't seen any of them.
So it's still sort of a miracle,
say. Oh yeah, definitely. And now, you're probably right in some ways, it's a symbol of Ireland, because if you go to Trinity College to see it, you have to wait on a long line to go see it. But I'm not sure when people do go see it, they actually see it. You know what I mean? It's hard, it's busy, it's small, it's about like that, you know, when you see it opened up, about like that. And there's people pushing you along and you can't linger. You learn more in the displays outside than you do inside.
But,
yeah.
You could almost touch it.
Yeah. Well, me too. When I was saying with you, the first time we went, it was in the long room at Trinity College, which is now where you go when you see the Book of Kells and you exit by going upstairs to the long room. That's where it was, which kind of nicer because the long room is very beautiful and impressive. But since they moved it down to this exhibition space and did a little more high-tech support of it, it's much more popular. And Celtic designs now start showing up in souvenir shops and ashtrays and God knows what else. So it helps. But I would like it to be more widely perceived as a symbol of Ireland than some of the cliched stuff that we get this time of year. You know, it's almost the time of year you want to go into hiding. With all the green beer and all that sort of stuff. You want to just take a break then, Tina, and your students can come back, whatever you want to do.
Any other questions? Comments?
I just wonder, Jim, did Joyce want for people to read his literature and put it to music? Did he ever talk about...
Well, I think he did, and a lot of it's been put to music. But the Finnegan's Wake, the title comes from a song. Some of you know the song. It's actually written by an American, Irish-American music, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake. It's a big Clancy Brothers song, if you come from that era. And Joyce liked the idea of that phrase, there's lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake. You know, same with my book. there's lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake. But I mean, I did my doctoral dissertation on Finnegan's Wake, so I put a lot of time into it. But I'll confess, I haven't gone back to it very often, and it's one, as I said at the beginning, one of the great unread books in Western literature. Joyce may have gone about as far as he could go with experimentation in Ulysses. And then Finnegan's Wake, which is about like that. It took him 17 years to write it, and he said it was only fair that people spend 17 years learning to read it. That's a lot to ask. That's a lot to ask. So it's out there and worth taking a look at. I wouldn't devote 17 years to it if I were you, but it's worth taking a look at. Read it just to get the feel for what the hell is this guy trying to do here. And then I think you can go back and see a growth from the very beginning with the young boy and the sister's fascination with words and young Stephen Dedalus's fascination with the spelling book, typesetting in Ulysses, the big S in Ulysses, the lack of punctuation in Molly Bloom's soliloquy. You can see in that a continuity, which then I would take and leap back to the Book of Kells, rather than leaping in the other direction to the Yeats tradition. You know, I just realized I had a quote here. I'll give you, and then I'll definitely stop. This is from where'd it go now? Oh, this is from one of the early histories of Ireland, Giraldus Cambrensis, okay, the 11th century or thereabouts, traveling in Kildare. Came upon some book. Nobody knows if it's the Book of Kells or another type of book which has since been lost. You know, who knows how many of these types of books have been lost. But he said, this book contains the harmony of the four evangelists according to Jerome, where for almost every page there are different designs distinguished by varied colors. Here you may see the face of majesty divinely drawn. Here are the mystic symbols of the evangelists, each with wings, now six, now four, now two. Here the eagle, there the calf, there the man, here the lion, and other forms almost infinite. Look at them, this is what Joyce liked about learning to read. Okay? Now, Joyce said his writing was not for the skimmer of pages. You know what I mean? You had to work at it. You had to learn to read it. You had to appreciate it. You had to be an active reader. You know what I mean? You don't go to McDonald's and ask to speak to the chef, you know what I mean? You go to McDonald's, you know what you're going to get. That's what you get when you go to the airport and buy a book to read on the plane or take you to the Jersey Shore. it entertains you, passes the time. It's good, but you don't have to work at it. Really good work of art, a good piece of music, a good meal, good beer, good glass of wine. You have to work at it. You have to give back. You have to play with it. You know what I mean? See, what the hell's going on here? What's the things that went into this thing that I'm now experiencing? You don't do that with airport fiction. That's okay. Airport fiction is like McDonald's. It does the job. Gets you from one place to another without your tummy growling too much. But here, you students, you're being exposed to stuff. You have to give back to it. You can't say, don't say it's too hard. I don't like that painting. I don't understand it. I don't like Picasso. Look at it. Study it again. Look at it. You say, I don't like classical music. Listen to it. Listen to it. See what's going on. Then decide you don't like it. That's okay. So you have to learn to look. I'll finish here now. Fine craftsmanship is all about you, but you might not notice it. Look more keenly at it, and you will penetrate to the very shrine of art. You will make out intricacies so delicate and subtle, so exact and compact, so full of knots and links, with colors so fresh and vivid that you might say that all this was the work of an angel and not of a man. For my part, the oftener I see the book and the more carefully I study it, the more I am lost in ever fresh amazement and I see more and more wonders in the book. Oh, I think Joyce wanted you to do the same thing with his books. Okay, thanks. Appreciate it.
And there is a copy of the Book of Kells at Quinnid Mercy. Wasn't it the Friendly Sons that gave it to him?
It was. Yeah. And we're actually going to have our June quarterly meeting there on June 13th.
Oh, for Bloom's.
We have the Book of Kells on display. I'm actually going to give a short lecture that will include.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's good timing because it's 3 days before Bloomsday. June 16th is Bloomsday. If you don't know, Ulysses, 800 pages, takes place in 1 day. You would think there wouldn't be enough to say about 1 day, but if you look closely, if you look closely,
and that's a very fine copy. That's not just every place. There's very few in the United States, I think.
Yeah, we have a few reproductions here, but they're not like that.
That's understood.
Okay.
Why don't you give us one? Save up the money.
Okay. Thanks again.